harp singing here in East Tennessee actually grew out of a tradition that began in New England. And from all historical accounts that I have seen, the singing had gotten pretty bad in the churches at that time. People were kind of prone to singing the songs that they knew, but they didn't have any musical education. And so the quality of the singing was very poor, and the preachers of that time decided they needed to do something about that. And so they began to try to devise a way to teach people how to sight read music, even though a lot of times, of course, during the colonial times, a lot of people couldn't read or write. So they came up with a system of shapes for the musical scale. And then people could learn that shape, learn the sound that went with it and the tone that went with it, and then they could learn to sight read four-part harmony and read music, even though they couldn't, as I say, read or understand the normal round notes, or even oftentimes even read or write, period.
People say that they would not go across the street to listen to it, but they would travel for miles to sing it, because it's the joy of the singing together in community that creates a bond that just can't be beat. Our people are very different. We have people from many different backgrounds and interests and religious beliefs, and yet when we start singing, all of that just drops away. We are brothers and sisters, and that's certainly one of my most important communities. You know, music is healing, and it continues to be.
No, you gotta sing. Everybody has to sing.
All the weather, you see, Heavenly Father, and this time of year, Lord, we have many different types, and snow and rain and sunshine. But Lord, we thank you for this people, Heavenly Father, and the voices that we hear this evening. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you'd bless our singing. We'd ask, Heavenly Father, that you'd receive it, Lord, as it's intended, Lord, as worship to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
Our book was printed in Knoxville, Tennessee, and originally in the early 1840s, and became very popular very quickly. I was reading a historical account some time ago that said there was a 8th or 9th printing by the late 1840s, and they were still selling 5,000 or so copies of the book in the area at that time. So it was very popular very quickly, but during the Civil War times, of course, with the issues going on in the country, harp singing kind of fell to the wayside for a little while. But after the war, the book was reprinted in its form that we currently have and was called The New Harp of Columbia.
The four parts are seated in a hollow square. And there's four lines in most every song, and the top line is the treble or the high voices sung by both men and women. Usually across from them are the bass, which is almost always men with low voices. Then we have the altos, which is almost always women with low voices, and then the melody or the lead line, which is the third line down, which is primarily the main melody of the song. Although we like to note that in shape note singing, there's not one melody and then everybody else harmonizes with that. Each line has its own melody, and so everybody's got their own part to sing, and it all comes together to create four-part harmony. And uncles, and they felt that the music was dying out. I mean, they thought their generation might be the last generation to sing it, or their families might be the last ones to sing it. And they lamented the fact that the book was only known, or the shape notes singing was only known in this area in East Tennessee. Well, they had not traveled very much, obviously, but to know today that there are singings that go on all across the country, not
not using our book, but using a lot of different books in the same tradition. I think that is very heartening to see that interest and see that people are still moved by the music, either spiritually or just they find a connection with it in some way that gives them that few minutes of peace that they can have in their life. So I'm very proud of that.
Very religious, and so normally for people who are not religious like me, I would say please don't let the religious words stop you, because they are poetic, they're historical, and whether or not you believe in heaven or hell doesn't really matter when you're singing. So I think it's both the tone, the sound of the music, the vibrations that are healing, but also just being in community.
I think the biggest draw, perhaps, to this kind of singing is the people themselves and what it means to each individual. We kind of come together as a community of singers, not necessarily a community of any certain denomination or any certain faith. We have singers that are from all denominations and different faiths as well. But when we come together and we're singing this music and we're concentrating on that, we are seated in a square facing into the center, and traditionally the leader should stand in the center and face the melody, the section that is singing the melody, or the lead section as we call it. But as the group is singing and looking at the leader and thinking about the words, we kind of block the rest of the world out, and we come together in harmony. To me, to stand in the center of the square and hear the quality of the sound, all those voices blending together and coming to you in that center. And literally, there's times it feels to me that I can see and hear and feel the air vibrating around me with the sound. And it touches me spiritually. I think to me, it's as close to heaven as I can get here in this world.
All right, what about any of you folks that passed on this go-around? Anybody got anything else they'd like to leave before we close? Well, I don't see anybody jumping up. So we'll try number 95 for a closing song, Parting Hand. It's kind of been our tradition here at this singing. Use that as our close. So we'll do the poetry that is with the shapes and verse 11 and 12, please. Some of these days we're going to drive a toilet.
Maybe the whole singing itself.
The whole singing itself.
Me so, me so, so, me re, do.
There's always a lot of discussion about why are we called old harp singers. One of the common sayings in our area is when you're talking to someone, you're using your harp, or if you're singing, you're using your harp. And so my grandmother used to say that all the time, if you're going to sing, use your harp, use the voice that God gave you.